are back here today with our next installment of Howard Goodall's Story of Music. This is going in a completely different direction than I thought it was going to. Does this guy look a bit like Pierce Morgan? Hello everybody, Beethoven says hey. So I want to apologize for this video coming out a few days later. I was kind of like interrupted by a tornado the other day when I was trying to film this. So you know, you do what you can. We're in part two, so we're going to pick it up with Brahms today. But before we get into watching the video, I do want to revisit some of your comments from the last one and kind of have a little discussion about music. If you want to skip this part and go straight to the reaction or where we watched the video, then hit the reaction chapter in this video and go straight there. But for now, let's have a quick look at some of your comments. So our first comment comes from Undertaker66687. Very appropriate name for this era of music, I have to say. So it says, you should react to Gilbert and Sullivan. Their comic operas are really cool and they don't have the overly dramatic parts. Well, it already sounds more up my alley with comedy and a little less drama. So I definitely do want to react to some operas, and Gilbert and Sullivan is definitely on the list. In fact, I actually have this book by them on my bookshelf. It is the complete plays of Gilbert and Sullivan. I haven't really looked at it before, but kind of, you know, looks like this. It's a very old book and it's falling apart. It actually has a note here that says Lois Colonus or something dash 40. So I'm wondering if this is like 1940 that it's referring to. Anyway, I gotta put that back together. So yeah, I don't know if the plays are different from their operas or not. I'm not sure exactly what they wrote. I've said before that my only exposure to Gilbert and Sullivan is from the movie Star Trek Insurrection, where Picard and Data and Worf all sang a British tar, but definitely a very famous duo that I would like to check out. In fact, if you want to suggest which Gilbert and Sullivan opera I should start with, let me know. I will put that down on my list. So in the last video, they showed this nice like villa with these fountains and stuff in front of it, and I was wondering where the heck that came from, and I saw it had some palm trees with it, and I was like, are there palm trees in Europe? And a lot of you let me know that indeed there are palm trees in Europe. Nick Dowdy said that there are palm trees in Devon in Cornwall, thanks to the Gulf Stream. I would have never in a million years thought that there were palm trees in England, but apparently there are. Some of you let me know that there are palm trees in Scotland as well. I know that there are probably some in Spain and Italy around the Mediterranean areas. So what do you know? Europe has a bunch of palm trees I didn't know about. So I also found in this last video kind of disturbing all of these paintings about hell and, you know, just evil stuff in general. But there was one painting that had like a bust of something in the window, and I thought, I think I've seen this painting before, and I think that's supposed to be Beethoven. And Michael did let me know that that was indeed Beethoven that was in the window with Liszt at the piano. He also let me know that this era of music is actually the Romantic period, and that like Mozart, Haydn, and Beethoven were more of the classical period. So that's kind of good. That gives me some guidelines to go on, and I can definitely say that so far I prefer the classical period over the Romantic period. And towards the end of the last video, it started talking more about the Hungarians and the Austrians, but the music that they were playing, I was like, I've heard that in like Westerns, when like I can picture somebody from Mexico with like a sombrero on, like facing down a cowboy for some reason. And I was like, but the Spanish and the Austrians wouldn't have anything to do with each other. And then Anthony Mash left this comment, quote, the Austrians didn't have anything to do with the Spanish, quoting me. And he says that those words may come back to haunt me. And then I like scrolled down and saw this other comment by Blame Thand, which says, this might not be the reason for the music in the Westerns you mentioned, but Mexico was ruled by the Austrian Habsburg Emperor in the 1860s for a while. What? Yeah, so obviously this is something I don't know about in history. So, okay, there's something else to learn about when it comes to Mexico and I guess the Americas over here. But also, what the heck were the Austrians doing over here? That's kind of weird to me. And if you've seen my videos in the past, you know that I really enjoy the kind of more lighthearted, comedic stuff. So this era of music, the age of tragedy, it's very like Halloweenish, very death-focused, evil spirits, hell, that stuff. Not really the most appealing subjects to me personally. So I've been a little personally disturbed by all of this. And I was kind of like, what in the world was going on in Europe at this point where all of this was like an obsession for artists, apparently? And Thomas Orson says, "You're very curious about the dark themes, paintings, and murals from that era. They can be found everywhere in Europe in art galleries, museums, churches, cathedrals, etc. And some of our ancestors were obsessed with death and the afterlife, and it's highly reflected in much of the art of the time." So I guess we are kind of post-Napoleon at this time, but some people in the comments let me know that there were still a lot of revolutions and rebellions going on as well, and it still just was kind of a very unstable time in Europe. So that was probably fueling a lot of this. But kind of going back to the Spanish-sounding music that I heard in the Austrian or Hungarian stuff, Peter Buin, I apologize if I said that wrong, he let me know that Antonin Dvorak did a stint in New York, actually writing music. So that's why some of the Hungarian sounds might be more associated with the US and Western music. So that very well could be the case. So we'll see about that. I would actually like to look more into that and know more about his story. Mark Wood let me know that all of these horrible, devilish pictures were actually taken from Hieronymus Bosch from 1460 to 1516, so they weren't really synonymous with the time of the music that we're talking about, but they are kind of like timeless paintings. And going back to that fountain that I saw, I had to stop the video and I was like, where is this? Because it's really, really cool looking. Patsy T let me know that this is the fountains of the Villa d'Este, and it's located right outside of Rome in Italy. It was built in the 16th century, and the gardens are very famous and they are now a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It was just a really, really cool looking place. I would love to see it. There was also another painting with a guy at the piano playing, and there was a woman sitting next to him, and there was something on the piano bench behind him. And the way things were going, talking about like just Halloweenish type stuff, it looked at first glance like a stub, like a leg stub or something like that. I would not have put it past this in the painting, but a lot of you let me know that it was actually a woman's hat that was behind him. It was just like in a weird triangular type shape, and I didn't think about a hat. But it makes sense, you know, there was a woman sitting next to him, so it was probably her hat that was sitting on the piano bench. But I don't know, my mind was kind of in the gutter with this one because of just how horrible everything was. So thank you for correcting me on that. I'm relieved that it was a woman's hat. Okay, so I'm gonna leave it there with the comments. Thank you guys so much for leaving them. I did read through all of them, so just because I didn't mention yours here doesn't mean that I didn't see it. Your comments do give me, like I said, a lot of areas to go and research outside of these videos, so I really, really appreciate you sharing your knowledge with me. But for now, we're gonna get back into the Age of Tragedy. We're gonna see part two of this, starting out with Brahms. I'm curious to see what other composers he goes into. So far, this is not my favorite era of music from what I've seen. I definitely prefer the sounds of Beethoven and Mozart especially. I've actually been a bit surprised by Mozart because I'd never been particularly drawn to him in the past, but this series has kind of pointed out to me his music and kind of his philosophy behind his music, and I have to say that I can really get behind it because it's more of like my philosophy and how I like to look at the world. I had previously said that Mendelssohn was maybe my favorite composer, but I might have to kind of second guess that now. I'm really, really interested in looking more into Mozart. But some of you in the comments have also let me know that this is your favorite era of music. That's great. If you love this era of music, it's all very subjective, you know, based on personal taste. So let's get back into it and let's see what the Age of Tragedy, this romantic period, has for us.
Amongst the most popular collections of the type were Brahms's Hungarian dances of 1869 and 1880, for example. They're great fun and a polished, accessible format by a man from Hamburg. But let's be honest about it. If you played one of them to a passing Magyar milkmaid on the banks of the Danube River in 1870 and asked her what it was, she'd have likely answered, "Nice, some kind of fancy German music." The integration of pseudo-peasant style into the piano and orchestral mainstream was an unstoppable flood. To be fair, though, the fashion yielded many of the best-loved nuggets of 19th century music.
You know, I don't think I've heard any of these before. Best nuggets, huh? I heard this stuff.
No way.
I think the only Tchaikovsky that I'm really familiar with is the Nutcracker Suite. I really love listening to that, but I don't think I've heard very much of his other stuff.
Nowhere were the moral questions surrounding the borrowing of elements from ethnic music and putting them into mainstream music more fiercely debated than in the United States of America. In the late 19th century, middle-class Americans were keen not to be outdone by their European counterparts, so they built concert halls, established orchestras, and invited star names across the Atlantic to perform. One such high-profile visitor was the Czech composer Antonín Dvořák.
Dvořák. Okay, Dvořák. I really mispronounced his name. Okay, so we're getting into kind of the stuff that comment maybe brought up. So this should be interesting.
But when he was headhunted to run a music college in New York in 1892, at 20 times the salary he'd been getting doing the same thing in Prague,
wow.
It had an odd effect on his musical compass. The most famous result of Dvorak's sojourn in the United States was his Ninth Symphony from the New World, with its now very familiar slow movement.
Yeah, this music I would associate with the West, you know.
It's an innocently memorable tune, rather like a hymn. Indeed, it was later given holy words and turned into one, prompting some to assume, wrongly, that Dvorak had borrowed an actual African-American spiritual for his melody. But there were other tunes in the symphony that triggered a more heated debate on whose music belongs to whom. This is one of them. Denied.
So this music is definitely stuff that I would associate with the Westerners, like going to the West, pioneers, Westerns, cowboys in general. I don't know if I've actually heard this piece, but it sounds like vaguely familiar. And maybe it's just because it has that tone to it, like that Western tone. It's really interesting to me that a Hungarian, was he Hungarian or Austrian? I can't remember what he said, is the one that came up with this very kind of Americana type sound. A foreigner did. That's really interesting to me.
Though he denied it, Dvorak was repeatedly asked whether this tune was an actual Native American folk tune. Certainly sounds like one. What's more, Dvorak urged his composition students in New York to go out and find Native American and African American folk songs to incorporate into their classical music. Why did it matter, though, whether the tunes were borrowed or newly composed? It mattered because this was a period when the USA's official policy, called Manifest Destiny, permitted the violent appropriation of the lands of Native Americans for the benefit of white settlers. Consciously or not, adopting the music of non-whites who actually were oppressed was a risky strategy. It could have emphasized just how powerless, excluded, and ripe for exploitation they were. Which is why the symphony, as well as being the source of much musical enjoyment, has caused some soul-searching as well over the years. The moral debate as to whether it's ethical for a richer people to adapt the music of a poorer people for their musical entertainment, often uncredited and unpaid, has never gone away, and it's just as hotly debated in our own time, not least in the fields of blues, jazz, and world music.
don't know. What do you guys think about that? I totally understand where they're coming from with that. But on the other hand, you could have the perspective of you're kind of like putting that music up on a pedestal as well. You're kind of honoring it in a way. And these composers, by taking some of those tunes, they have the audience that otherwise wouldn't be there, and they are kind of exposing this music to the rest of the world by doing that. So I don't know, like, you could look at it two different ways. You could look at it as like this kind of inappropriate appropriation of the music, or you could also say, well, it's actually taking the music that's really good and sharing it with the rest of the world. I think personally, I would kind of tend to look at it the second way, where it's kind of more like you're honoring that music and those cultures. I mean, you look at even artists like Elvis Presley, where he took a lot of the African American sounds and styles and kind of transferred that over to rock and roll, and he is the one who kind of made all of that famous. So I don't know, what's your opinion on it? I know, like you said, it's a very hotly debated topic. There are different ways of looking at it. I can see both sides of it, so.
In 1895, Dvorak, desperately homesick, returned to his native Bohemia, the subject of the great body of his music, which, especially his Slavonic dances, was a hymn to Czech nationalism.
Bohemia. Where is Bohemia? Exactly. I'm sounding like a very dumb American here, but I actually don't know where Bohemia is. I've heard it a lot, you know, Bohemian Rhapsody, that type of stuff, but I've never actually thought about where it actually is. Is it a city or is it just kind of an area of Europe that's called Bohemia? Enlighten me on that, please. What's interesting about this is that when he goes back to Bohemia, his music goes back to that kind of more European sound. So it's really interesting to me how he kind of adapted his styles depending on where he was. I would really like to look more into this and maybe look at a documentary on just Dvorak and his musical journey that he had in different areas of the world.
But any awkwardness we may feel about Dvorak and nationalism is a walk in the park compared to the hornet's nest provoked by Liszt's most needy and argumentative disciple of them all. Liszt innovation number 7, Richard Wagner.
Wagner is his innovation.
The composer Liszt most influenced was his own future son-in-law and self-appointed savior of all art himself, Richard Wagner. The colossus of Wagner is an inescapable reality of late 19th century music, indeed of recent Western civilization. That's because Wagner's style was so particular, his agenda so ambitious, and his stature as a German national figure so all-embracing that he was an act no normal mortal composer could hope to follow. Worshipped unlike any other composer in history, the claims for Wagner's status as the architect of modern theatre and the godfather of modern music have been, well, Wagnerian.
I've never heard of any of this regarding Wagner before. Now, granted, I don't know very much about him, but of course, he's a very famous name in classical music. I don't really know his music very well. I've not heard much about him, but I definitely didn't know this about him. They're making him out to be like this really kind of grand figure in classical music, but I just never, like, when I think about classical music, Wagner is not anywhere close to the first name I think of. Let's see where this is going.
But how well do those extravagant claims stand up to scrutiny, and how much, in fact, did he owe to Liszt? Wagner has been credited with innovations to music's development. He did not, in fact, innovate. Take harmony, for example. The cliché is that Wagner began dismantling the way harmony, the manipulation of chords, had been working happily for a few hundred years. One way he did this dismantling was to take a chisel to the common triad, the basic building block of all Western harmony. So he'd take a simple chord, like C minor, and squash it. Alternatively, he'd take the simple chord of C major and stretch it. These techniques are known in the trade as diminishing and augmenting chords. Diminishing or augmenting chords does strange things to the way they behave. They become unstable, creating a sense of nervousness, of anxiety, and uncertainty.
So I do know about diminished and augmented chords. I've been around in music enough to have heard those terms, but I can't honestly give you a very technical explanation as to what they are exactly. Obviously, he said that it's kind of like squashing them or stretching them out a little bit. And I do know that like minor chords, for instance, do create that feeling of like uneasiness, and a lot of composers use minor chords to kind of get that tone across in their music.
I'm unstable, creating a sense of nervousness, of anxiety, and uncertainty. Wagner uses them prolifically in his operas to evoke pain or anguish, or to tell you something grim is about to happen. In the first part of the Ring cycle, for example, angry, diminished chords are often used to signify the dangerous power of the ring itself. Diminished and augmented chords Wagner may have made his own, but they were first used in abundance by Liszt. His Faust Symphony of 1855, yes, he did one too, begins with an anguished opening theme entirely made of augmented chords broken up into a tune.
Back to these paintings again.
Very soon, there's an outbreak of demonic pain punched out in a series of diminished chords. While we're on the subject of chords, diminished and augmented, and Wagner's debt to Liszt, we need to tackle Wagner's most famous chord. So famous, in fact, that it has its own name. Lengthy tomes have been written about it, and academics have based whole PhDs on it. It is called the Tristan chord. The Tristan chord comes from Wagner's opera, Tristan and Isolde, and whilst it has been accorded the kind of mystique and reverence usually reserved for the Holy Grail, or Einstein's special theory of relativity, it is, when all is said and done, wait for it, a diminished chord.
People have written PhD dissertations, I'm guessing, on stuff like that. I mean, I get it, I guess you could probably do that, but also this guy, he looks familiar to me. Does this guy look a bit like Pierce Morgan to you? I think that's what I'm thinking about here.
Wagner's debt to Liszt is so great that it's fair to make the perhaps shocking statement that there is no innovation, no technique, no supposed great leap forward in expression or style anywhere in Wagner's monumental output that is not found somewhere first in Liszt. But, and this is a big but, notwithstanding Wagner's frequent borrowings from Liszt, it will be churlish not to stress that the greatest composers have always tended to synthesize the styles and currents of their time. And Wagner's music, in any case, has far better tunes than Liszt's.
It definitely sounds a lot more melodic than this. I think I've heard this before.
Tristan and Isolde is an out-and-out masterpiece with sweeping, yearning themes, deserving of its place in music's pantheon, whatever it may or may not have innovated. Like Verdi's La Traviata 12 years earlier, it's about a doomed love affair, death and destiny, of course. There is, however, one very important difference between Verdi and Wagner. Wagner chose, quite deliberately, to restructure opera in direct defiance of the established tradition as developed over 200 years, mostly by Italians. The Italian way was to divide up the opera into clearly defined songs, called arias, narrative, prose-like singing that carried the plot, called arioso, duets, trios, and sweeping choruses, with a bit of ballet thrown in. Italian opera was therefore like a variety show. Wagner threw this out and replaced it with a continuous musical flow, with all those elements mixed in together into one seamless whole. He decided that his best source material wouldn't be other operas, but the powerful symphonic tradition of the concert hall that was dominated by Germans, especially Beethoven, and wannabe Germans like Berlioz and Liszt.
Wannabe Germans.
What's more, Wagner's main subjects were thoroughly German too. His operas are made up of stories from history and myth, which put archetypal Germanic heroes to the test, like Tannhäuser, Lohengrin, and the Mastersingers. Or they concern themselves with sacrifice and denial, like Tristan and Isolde and Parsifal. Or they confront the inevitability of the corruption of power. Or all of the above at once, as is the case in Wagner's monumental four-opera cycle, The Ring of the Nibelung. It took Wagner 26 years to create his epic Ring cycle. To stage it, Wagner had his own theatre erected, designed to his own specifications at Bayreuth in Bavaria. For its first complete performance, he decreed that the house lights should be dimmed. This was such a novelty at the time, it drew gasps from the audience. He also hid the orchestra under the stage and instigated theatrical effects never before attempted.
Okay, so this is kind of what they were referring to with he's like one of the founders of modern theater. Huh. I didn't know that they didn't dim the lights previous to this. That's interesting. Also the orchestra pit, special effects, that sort of thing.
Wagner's ambition was nothing less than the creation of the art form of the future, in which all the arts would combine and fuse, led by the unequally greater power of music. In order to do so, he needed a toolkit of components and systems at his command. One such technique is his use of fragments of melody, or rhythm, or harmony as calling cards of a character, a place, an idea, or a thing. These fragments, or cells, from which he created the whole web of the music, are called leitmotifs. Whatever Wagner worshippers tell you, Wagner didn't invent the leitmotif idea. The credit for that lies squarely with the opera composer and distinguished writer E.T.A. Hoffmann.
I have heard of leitmotifs before. I believe we covered this in my music appreciation course. I think it's just, you know, the kind of theme song of whatever particular like character, for instance. In the show.
It for that lies squarely with the opera composer and distinguished writer E.T.A. Hoffmann, 60-odd years earlier. Just thought you should know. Wagner perfected the leitmotif technique in all his mature operas, particularly his Ring cycle. But in his final opera, Parsifal of 1882, he went one stage further, giving his leitmotifs what he hoped would be sacred power. Amongst Parsifal's 20 or so principal leitmotifs, for example, there's one for the Holy Grail itself, one of the key ingredients in the legend on which the plot is based, which sounds like an amen in sacred music. And there's one for the concept of suffering. Parsifal himself has one, the hero of the story, an innocent fool who is redeemed by pity. His motif is usually played by the heroic trombones and horns, naturally. once you start combining, modifying, and transforming these tiny cells of melody or harmony, though, the possibilities are virtually endless, which is how Wagner derives such richness from the technique.
Yeah, this stuff just doesn't do it for me. I don't know what it is. Just, it's not very intriguing to listen to. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I'm willing to watch operas. Maybe I'll get into it more if I watch, like, a full opera. But I just have to say, like, video after video, when I see these clips from operas, they just don't pull me in. Except for some of Verdi's, like, tunes that I heard before that were kind of popular. I have to say, this set, though, looks really, really cool. I'm really curious as to what the floor is made out of. It looks kind of tricky to walk on, for instance.
The second musical hallmark Wagner puts to work in Parsifal is a technique called chromaticism. It comes from the Greek word meaning colour and is the musical equivalent of filling a canvas with thousands of colours instead of just a few. In the music of Mozart or Beethoven, say, there was a hierarchy of chords, a bit like the pieces in a game of chess. The king chord was the chord of the key the piece was written in, C major, for example. Then there were queen, bishop, knight, and castle chords, all more important than the humble pawns. What chromaticism did was to weaken these hierarchical relationships, eventually making all chords as powerful as the others. This did away with the sense of coming home in a piece of music. It was a deliberate attempt to make harmonies unfamiliar, unstable, and more exotic in flavor.
You guys know from my previous videos that I like that coming home feeling. That's what makes a piece of music memorable to me and listenable. But when you get into stuff like this, it just isn't as much fun to listen to. Just to my ear, personally, some of you guys might really enjoy this type of music. But I had a feeling that this is where this was going, where it's just going to be kind of that meandering tune that doesn't really go anywhere.
In the opening prelude of Parsifal's third act, the music shifts and slides around, deliberately avoiding settling on one key or chord. This is extreme chromaticism at work. You're meant to feel disorientated and in the grip of mysterious powers. The harmony's in meltdown because Wagner has used chromaticism to put you in an unhomely and unsettling place. As for the plot, well, Parsifal doesn't have one so much as a series of ritualistic scenes. Set in medieval Spain, it's a quasi-religious happening, set against a parable about the Holy Grail, guarded by the Knights Templar in their secret castle, Montsalvat. The work is complete with symbols, magic, and time travel. But there's a deadly serious idea. That personal redemption is achieved by resisting temptation and seeking an understanding of fellow suffering. Compassion has a healing and liberating power. There's nothing mad or fanciful about this idea, and the first and third acts of Parsifal, the acts that take place in the Grail's mountain refuge of Montsalvat, contain music of breathtaking grandeur and beauty to match the aspiration of the beliefs underpinning it.
The style of opera, but I have to say that their sets are next level for sure. That is an incredible set. I like the grandiose sound. It's just like the storytelling and the way they do it.
Parsifal is the work of a mountainous talent, seeking to give meaning to the world around him, to guide humanity towards his vision of enlightenment. There's another side to the philosophy behind Parsifal, though, a side that for some Wagner worshippers flipped a switch. It's not possible to sidestep the fact that the climax of this crusader story focuses on the magical properties of the spear that allegedly pierced the side of the crucified Jesus of Nazareth. The pure blood of Christ, the Holy Grail containing it, and the sacrificial significance of Good Friday are all presented as both real and miraculous. The holy blood itself is seen as purifying, purging the evil, the weak, and the sinful. Plotting against the innocent Christian Parsifal is the Darth Vader of the tale, a malicious sorcerer called Klingsor. Until the 1950s, portrayed in Bayreuth productions as of Arabic or Jewish origin. He's accompanied by a possessed shapeshifter, Kundry, a reincarnation of the cursed Jewish princess Herodias. Klingsor forces Kundry to seduce Parsifal in the hope of contaminating his purity.
What in the world are these stories coming from? This is crazy to me. So they have shapeshifters and time travel in medieval times, all like in the spear of Christ, and what? This is a very complicated story with a bunch of elements to it that just don't make any sense to me. By the way, this CO2 that's spilling over the edge of this set right here, I used to do that stuff in theater, setting that up and making it run.
Kundry even enlists the help of her teenage daughters in the task of seducing him. It's not exactly a family show, Parsifal. The much-abused slave whore Kundry, having converted to Christianity at the last moment and been released from the curse that's trapped her in time, is duly killed off at the moment the pure Parsifal becomes chief protector of the Grail, blessed by a dove from heaven.
It's like some weird like sci-fi mixed with fantasy and mythology and horror. So bizarre.
Kundry's final humiliation and the triumph of the Aryan hero Parsifal were not very subtly concealed metaphors for what Wagner wanted to happen to German culture. Politically, his agenda was to give the Germans a sense of their historical destiny. And to fulfill that destiny, as he conceived it, he firmly believed that it would be necessary to remove all Jews and all traces of Jewish culture from the German Reich.
Wait.
Unfortunately.
No way. So Wagner was like a Nazi? Well, I guess Nazis didn't exist at his time, maybe, but precursor to it, maybe? What? I didn't know any of this about him.
In the newly unified Germany of the late 19th century, anti-Semitism was rampant, but Wagner's views were excessive even by the standards of the time. Within just 40 years, the anti-Semitism and ultra-German nationalism of the 1880s had evolved into the cancerous ideology of Nazism. It's no good pretending Wagner wasn't accessory to this slide into xenophobic vitriol. In one of his many anti-Semitic publications, Wagner said all contact with Jews was insufferable to any true German, and that only their annihilation would solve the Jewish question.
I have never understood, what do people have against Jews in particular? It's just, I don't know what it is. Like, why? Particularly in Germany, was something going, like, did the Jews do something in Germany to spark this? I just don't get this. I've never gotten why people don't like Jews.
The Nazi top brass treated Wagner's opera house at Bayreuth as a holy shrine, a place of pilgrimage and reverence. They were welcomed with open arms by Wagner's surviving family members and the Bayreuth elite.
All right, this is going in.
The beaming hostess here is Winifred Wagner, an English woman who was Wagner's daughter-in-law.
This is going in a completely different direction than I thought it was going to. I didn't expect to get into this with a music video. Wow, this is kind of like shocking me about Wagner. I had no earthly idea about any of this.
Bayreuth, in fact, had become Montsalvat itself, the mountaintop resting place of the Holy Grail, the high temple of Aryan culture. Knowing how the message of Parsifal became distorted by Nazism, it's uncomfortable for us to hear Wagner's sublime music without wincing. In one way, this became the most dangerous music ever written, because despite being motivated by a devotion to compassion, it inspired hatred. Mm. Parsifal was put on 23 times in Berlin alone during the period of the Third Reich.
That is kind of sad, though, that an opera that didn't really have anything to do with this was kind of, like you said, twisted into this horrible ideology. Which I guess, you know, if that ideology was also Wagner's, then, you know, there's something to that. But it sounds like he didn't write the opera with that intent, so.
It's not so far-fetched to suggest that without his link to the Nazis, most people who are not hardcore opera lovers would by now have lost interest in Wagner. That may sound harsh, but the musical evidence of Wagner's impact is nothing like as convincing as his disciples would have us believe. Everywhere you look in the 1880s, outside Bayreuth, you see composers carrying on as if nothing has happened. I'm not just talking about Brahms in Vienna plowing on with his symphonies undeterred, but about Offenbach in Paris with his knockabout satire and frilly knickers, Johann Strauss the Younger in waltz-mad Vienna, Bizet's sensuous Carmen with its catchy tunes, or Gilbert and Sullivan's witty and effervescent operettas. These were broad and threatening entertainments that anyone with the price of a ticket could enjoy.
Sounds like I would probably enjoy those composers, though. But that's really interesting that they kind of ignored Wagner's innovations, sort of, and kind of just carried on with their own thing.
Which is precisely why dedicated followers of Wagner look down their noses at such flotsam and jetsam. Mass audiences weren't deterred by the snobbery directed at them. They never are. But what became misleadingly labelled as serious classical music started to believe it was in some other realm, untainted by all that light, frothy musical fun. Wagner's acolytes were happy to retreat into their increasingly exclusive and lofty club, where only the initiated, the learned, and the bold would venture to tread. Their attitude would eventually lead the composer Arnold Schoenberg to declare in 1946, "Those who compose because they want to please others and have audiences in mind are not real artists."
Yeah, see, like, this is still a thing even today where people who write, like, more independent music will look down on the more, like, mass pop music and say, well, you know, that's just cheap trash to appeal to the masses. You know, our music is so much better. It's got a message and more soulful, and it's got these, you know, different sounds and all of that. So yeah, I get it. I guess I would be lumped in with the masses, the poor dumb masses here that doesn't understand Wagner's music. I mean, like, I get it on an intellectual level. He's experimenting with different sounds, trying to be different, and I do respect that because, in a certain sense, I'm kind of like that too, where I don't necessarily like to follow the crowd. Also, you have to acknowledge that sometimes, you know, the music with mass appeal is just a heck of a lot of fun, and that doesn't make it any less artistic than, you know, the more what people will consider highbrow music.
This disastrous schism between high and low art had its seeds in Wagner's supreme arrogance, like that of a high priest, swallowing up all the arts into his musical blueprint for the destiny of humankind.
This guy's really full of himself.
It was understandable that Wagner might want to speculate about the artwork of the future, one that would encompass within it all the arts, centered on human dramas of love, death, and destiny. But it wasn't to be his vision that fulfilled the promise. Motion pictures were the artwork of the future, a technological breakthrough that stuttered into life just after his death. Mm. Wagner's main contribution to the music that followed him was that all the key composers of the next 30 years, particularly outside Germany, were inspired not to emulate him, somehow find an alternative and completely repudiate him.
I've seen this movie, by the way, in my film history classes.
In the next program, an age of revolution, more radical and savage than anything Wagner could have imagined, was about to tear music apart. Rebellion and subversion, political and musical, was in the air.
Okay, well, the ending of that was really interesting to me because we're going to see it looks like a 180 from Wagner, where a lot of the newer composers that came after him decided to kind of do the exact opposite. It kind of sounds like I might enjoy those composers a little bit because I definitely am not feeling Liszt and Wagner in this whole era of music. Kudos to all of you whose favorite era is this. That's, again, perfectly fine. Everybody has their own personal taste that they enjoy. For me, it is the era previous to this is my favorite so far. Definitely prefer the happier, more optimistic view on things. Although I do absolutely respect the experimentation of these composers of this era, where they took a lot of the older styles and they kind of dismantled them and did their own thing and played around with new and different things. It's not that appealing for me personally to listen to, but I absolutely respect people who try to innovate and do something different. So for that, Liszt and Wagner do have my respect. But Wagner, you know, with the whole, like, you know, Nazi philosophy that he had, plus that more, like, elite vision of music that he had, and he looked down on the masses, I really don't like that about him. I would like to learn more about him just from more of an academic standpoint, so I understand this era and him better. But I have to say, just for, like, personal listening pleasure, Liszt and Wagner probably would not be on my playlist. That said, I do want to listen to their music a little bit more just to be more familiar with it. But I am looking forward to this next episode. We're going to be getting to episode 5 of 6. It looks like we're going to be getting more into 20th century, more modern style of music. I'm really, really interested in where it goes after all of this. So I hope you guys will join me next time for that. Also, if you enjoyed this video, make sure that you like and subscribe. We've got a lot more Howard Goodall coming your way, plus a lot more like UK history stuff. So stay tuned for all of that. And Beethoven here, and I will see you next time.